It's a fun game. Yes, it's a funny old game. And to prove it, I've got some hilarious moments to share with you as I take a personal, offbeat look at the crazy world of sport. I've dug up some nice little clips from the sporting archives, and I'll be putting the emphasis on the funny face of football. And talking of funny faces, see if you can recognise some of the golden oldies as we dip back into the past to see how the game used to be played.
In the office of my business, waiting for my two co-directors to come along. We're going to have a little meeting, discuss problems.
So even when you're not playing football, you're still working?
Sometimes.
Don't you find it strange to have a Saturday off and no football at all?
Well, it doesn't seem a Saturday. This happened last week when we were due to play Ipswich, and it's happened again this week. And to me, it just doesn't seem like a Saturday.
Do you think this plonker who doesn't know which day it is has any future in television? I'm being interviewed here by a young John Bromley, who later became my boss at London Weekend Television. See if you can recognise an 18-year-old youngster about to get the chance to score from the penalty spot after this amazing bit of impulsive goalkeeping. Yes, it's Kevin Keegan, who was just starting out on his career with Scunthorpe before making a name for himself at Liverpool and All Points West. And here's how a Manchester United hero looked at his peak in 1966, the toothless tiger Nobby Stiles, who these days has a good pair of gnashers on.
Powerhouse Joe Jordan and the old Superman Malcolm McDonald are also out of the Nobby Stiles school of toothless tigers. It takes two to tango, Mora. It's a goal for Liverpool. And the fan smacks one against the post. One. Two, three. We're all down for the count. Rodney Marsh is whispering, tell him your name's Donald Duck. Sheer perfection from Peter Osborne. And the Kiss of Death from Tony Curran. This Mike Shannon goal has to wait for the stamp of approval. Little Ozzy Ardiles puts his case for the defence. The linesman says he went that away. The verdict goes against Spurs, and I think Ozzy wants a second opinion. Got away with that one, Mike. And here's Franny Lee getting away with one for Manchester City against him. Here's another little rumpus which ends with the goalkeeper, Hugh Davis, getting his marching orders for breaking the golden rule. Never touch a referee. There was nobody in the good old, bad old days to touch Leeds players for laying down the law. Times when the law had to lay down the fangs. Of course, you could always try to sweet talk your way out of trouble. Now we come to a sequence that shows that no matter what the weather, the show must go on. This is Billy Bonds managing to squelch the ball into the net. Charlie George gives a black power salute. Just watch the sticky mess Roger Davis gets his Derby teammates into with this crazy back. Yet more mud, glorious mud. Including this Arsenal classic in the puddles of Paris back in 1934.
Staying with football the way it used to be, see if you can believe your eyes as you watch this clip from the Rangers versus Moscow Dynamo match at Hampden in 1946.
Within 2 minutes, Kasev opened the score. I mentioned before that the play was inclined to be robust, and so it was. Presently, a foul against Williamson was allowed. Waddell took the kick, but Comich, the Tiger, saved.
Hold on, let's rewind and take another look at that. Did you spot this Rangers player who had obviously gone flat out for victory? He looks like a punctured inflatable doll. Here's to you, Jock. I reckon the old Russian Tiger could have made a fortune with the Hammer House of Horror.
The Dynamos remain unbeaten.
Talking of horrors, here I am pioneering the Saint and Greasy show. I still can't quite believe that flat-as-a-pancake Rangers player. He looked as if he'd been run over by a steamroller. I don't think Paul Gascoigne will ever look as flat as that. And it's that great character Gazza who kicks off our next section that we've called Would You Believe It? And you'll soon know why. Sweet smell of success.
This can only mean one thing, soccer again. Apparently some 60,000 have heard there's a match at Highbury.
Yes, it's hot stuff at Highbury. And this is Gary Sprake giving Bobby Gould a knuckle sandwich. But they laugh their way through the return match. It's all out war, and I don't think the last player plans to use this as a flag of truce.
Now that's what you call a miss. You ain't seen nothing yet. This happened in a match in Ireland. The goalkeeper brought the bar crashing down and caused a long hold-up. When he did it a second time, the referee decided he'd had enough. I wonder if he went off to the bar. It's a funny old game.
This is the best tackle Wembley has seen outside the Rugby League Challenge Cup final. I think goalkeepers are too muddy-puddled these days. Why shouldn't this player be allowed to use his head? I didn't touch him, ref. Honest. And who shoots this goalkeeper? A little domestic tiff. Look, Bruce has dropped his head. Where's that one gone, Jeff? Should touchlines be no smoking zones? A goal like this one from Charlie George is enough to make any manager smoke. Ouch! All fall down. And now we come to all creatures, great and small. Sign him up for Rovers. Poor old pussycat got netted. No, it's not Catty Benetti. Sepp Maier fails to get a birdie. Here comes a Norman Hunter bites your legs tackle. My sentiments entirely. This is stretching it a bit.
Here's Cluffy, and he's not clowning around. Perhaps he thought it was a certain Polish goalkeeper.
Now a drop of the hard stuff. Human corkscrew. Enjoy the trip. Sorry, I thought we were playing rugby. Out of the way, ref. Only Bobby Moore would have thought of blowing the whistle to stop the game after knocking out the referee. I think he's calling him a worker. Even at top level, goals often come more by accident than desire. Salt that lot, ref. Off you go, Georgie boy. The ball has hit poor old Danny Thomas where he wouldn't show his mouth. Here's an obvious handball that the referee saw. But this light-fingered work by Pop Robson escaped the ref's attention. It looks as if he's under arrest. Never mind, eh? The headless wonder. Great minds think alike.
And now for something completely different. Where would the game be without the creative and inventive players who could put some fun into football? Here's a tribute to the entertainers, those footballers who have brought the game alive with their skill and their electrifying reactions. They have made our football game for a laugh. Biggest tongue in the West, Gaz has got a whole catalogue of expressions. But can he match this little man, Diego Maradona? Entertainer since his tearful debut as a 17-year-old in the 1958 World Cup finals.
Celebrates a classic goal, Little Rock and Roll. Here's big brother Jack getting in on the goal scoring act. Jack's the first of the parade of managers we feature in the next sequence. Joe Royal's now a big shot with Oldham. A cracker there from George Graham, now the big boss at Highbury. This is Steve Coppell being accused by Tottenham's Terry Naylor of taking a dive. Here's Terry Venables keeping his air on. And how about this for a collector's item? That's Emlyn Hughes catching the post before running into the welcoming arms of none other than the Saint. Here, in my opinion, is the king of the British entertainers, the one and only Dennis Law. And this is Alan Ball giving his impression of a Thunderboots player. Bobby Moore gratefully accepts a goal on the plate and then explains how it should be done. All count. I wonder what Franny Lee had to say to his old teammate Mike Summerby after collecting this soft goal for Derby. I think that this strange ritual by Bob Wilson would have put off any penalty taker. The thigh-high shows certainly seem to throw Mike Doyle. Charlie George has good reason to feel pleased with himself after this stunning goal. The old dude is having a ball. Here's Trevor Francis in his boy wonder days at Birmingham City. And this is pleased as punch, Stan Bowles. Football's a tough old game. This is Martin Chivers getting a mouthful of boot as well as a goal. And here's another bloody hero, Frank Worthington. Stuart McCall gets down to the bare essentials as he stops Gazza from scoring. Did Lee Chapman dive or was he pushed? I reckon the only thing missing was a swimming pool. Phew, this is hard work. Bob Latchford is happy to accept the gift of the goal, but he doesn't want anybody near that damaged eye of his. Just look at the way Hungarian master Ferenc Puskas has changed over the years. But most of all, he was weighed down with talent and he carried all before him. This is what you call attacking in numbers. At one stage, you will see 10 Liverpool players on the screen and not an opponent in sight. No wonder they call them the Red Army. Even the snowman is impressed. And so's this little whippersnapper. Now there's a player with plenty of bounce. Rodney Marsh and George Best had a great double end going to Fulham. And here's the evidence. Bobby Moore as Big Chief sitting. Peter Osgood and Norman Hunter, what a match. And Ian Botham looks as if Norman Hunter has bitten him. Same to you, dude. This is your captain speaking. Ian Hutchinson used to really throw defences with this party trick for Chelsea. Ray Clements had lightning fast reaction. Ask Franny Lee. The entertainers are not only on the pitch, just watch Cluffy at work on the touchline bench. Up at the top. Penalty to Liverpool. But you should not count on a goal with the Irish master Pat Jennings between the posts. Ask Tommy Smith. Kiss a smile, Kenny. This is Radio Mullery being taken off the air. And Big Mal gives us the elbow. His master's voice.
Big Mal Allison playing the Mad Hatter there, but there was nothing mad in his methods. He has been one of the all-time great coaches. I remember him telling goalkeeper Joe Corrigan after he'd helped the ball into his own net, "I thought I knew all the ways a goal could be scored, but today you've found a new one." Well, here are a few more variations on the goal scoring theme. Got to be one of the all-time great own goals. Do you think this policeman might be a Liverpool fan?
That's Peter Lorimer scoring at the wrong end. They go in from all distances. Lovely header, wrong net. A present for Sniffer Clark. And a gift for Mick Joe. "Thank you very much," says Martin Peters. And Tony Curry is equally grateful. This makes up for that own goal by Peter Lorimer. Watch out for players on a collision course. Whoops! Here's the goalkeeper's nightmare. The ball through the legs. This is John Holland. Being put to the bar.
It's a funny old game.
This is Kevin Hector getting netted.
You won't see a better chip than this. And how about this for magical stuff from the George Best treasure chest?
Duke was pleased to be a daddy long legs of the player. Heard of goal hanging, but this is ridiculous.
That was a classic goal by Glenn Hoddle at White Hart Lane. A few years earlier at the same ground and wearing a Spurs shirt, I stole one of my most satisfying goals against Liverpool. And just watch how the old saint gets himself all worked up. Lovely stuff. Quite right, Lions. You tell him, Saint. chair on, Emlyn. That's Terry Venables and Alan Mullery plotting a foul deed. Who's a nice boy then? Pick that one out. Ah, happy days. That was Tommy Lawrence in goal for Liverpool. He was affectionately known on the Kop as the Flying Pig and was that rarity, a Scottish goalkeeper with a safe pair of hands. There's a saying in football that all goalkeepers are crazy. See what you think after watching this next sequence that we've called Jeepers Keepers. How this nutty Peruvian goalkeeper was allowed to stay on the pitch, I'll never know. Is there a more expressive goalkeeper than our Brucey at Liverpool? We'll be right back.
Goalkeeper Graham Smith once did this to Colchester and the bar came crashing down on his head.
Here's a skeleton from Bob Wilson's cupboard. It's a funny old game. Cheeky Gordon.
Een heel bijzonder doelpunt dat u nog eens te zien krijgt. Het hoofd van Kusters blijft gelukkig op zijn plaats. Paul van Ostaaien heeft het ooit anders meegemaakt.
I couldn't have put it better myself. That was a real double Dutch goal. Now it's your chance to join in the fun with our guessing game. Just for laughs, in this final sequence, we widen the field to take in sports other than football, and we'll briefly freeze the action while you try to guess whatever next. Can you guess what's about to happen to the Queen's Park Rangers manager, Trevor Francis? Whatever next. That's Trevor's wife, Helen, giving him mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Can you guess what this goal scorer is about to do? Whatever next. I wonder if his manager tore him off a strip. Here's that great character, Bruce Grobbelaar, looking in trouble. Whatever next. Desperate save. And then Bruce got netted. Can you guess what's holding up the golden bear, Jack Nicklaus? Whatever next. Now that's what you call a real water hazard. Whatever next. If I'd have been the horse or rider being asked to clear this, I would have taken offence. The second horse had the right idea. What do you think's about to happen in this motocross race? Whatever next. Whoops, here's mud in your eye. The last ball of the test match. Whatever next. Poor old bowler was left with nothing. Can you guess what's about to happen to this Russian gymnast? Whatever next. Ouch.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome onto the ice to present the trophies, the wife of the director of our sponsors, Tuborg Lager.
Whatever next. No jokes about having too much lager. Whatever next. What goes up does not always come down. Whatever next. All fall down. Whatever next? That's what you call coming a cropper. Whatever next? This really threw him. Whatever next? Take that. Whatever next? He fell at the first. Can you guess what happened to the Wizard of Dribble, Stanley Matthews? Whatever next? Sir Stanley, the first footballer to be knighted, went one better in Ghana, where he was crowned King of Football. Whatever next? Well stopped, ref. Whatever next? Ouch. Now he's in a spin. Whatever next? This is how Barry Hughes taunted his rival manager during a Dutch league match. It's 1967, and England have just been beaten by the jocks at Wembley. Whatever next? The Scottish fans decided that Wembley belonged to them. They even took great chunks of the pitch over. What's George Best up to? And why is Mike Summerbee disguising himself? Whatever next? This was a charity match between Manchester United and an all-girls team. Knowing Georgie boy, I bet he scored. Finally, that man Gazza again. We know what's coming, don't we? Whatever next? It's a funny old game.